Hello, this presentation is Birding Basics. It was offered by Dr. Dan Scheinman from Bird Conservationist at Audubon, Arkansas. Dr. Scheinman allowed me to use this talk for my class, and I've actually modified it a little bit. It's not his original presentation. I've added a few things to it, but the basic skeleton is, and most of the photos are his. The point of the talk is to sort of introduce you to what birding is and bird watching in general. Introduce you to some of the cultural things over the last few years to decade in which birding has become a little more popular in popular culture. And in turn, that's influenced the number of birders who are coming to the hobby. And then we'll spend some time on just sort of what you need to get started, you know, field guides, phone apps that include field guides in them. And then of course, we need to talk about optics, binocular and spotting scope. And then just some other aspects of bird watching that will be important just to get started. We'll have other lectures on backyard birding, using native plants to attract birds to your yard, how to use eBird and the importance of eBird and citizen science data. And then I think our final presentation will be on the impact of global climate change on the bird populations over the next 25 years or so. So that's sort of the plan for the rest of the semester, and this talk will be the beginning of that. So let's just start off. What's the difference between birding and bird watching? Well, to me, they are different. Some people think they're interchangeable. I consider bird watching a little more passive. Bird watching is something I do when I'm sipping coffee in the morning, sitting in my lawn chair while watching my feeder birds. You know, what birds are coming to my feeders or on the periphery of my lawn as they come to and from feeders. I consider that bird watching. I consider birding a more active activity where I'm actually going out into the environment. Maybe it's a place I've never even been before, looking for species of birds I've never seen before. So it's more exploratory. That's what I consider birding. And it's something I'm actively doing. And and the whole purpose is to see more birds and more habitats. Because there's a little over 10,000 known species of birds on the planet. It's going to be hard for any one person to see all of them, even in a lifetime. So, but one aspect of birding is you can just, no matter where you live, you can just try and see as many birds as you can and get to know them and know them well and be able to identify and separate them from the other birds in the same area. So that's sort of the challenge of birding on the individual level. So it's kind of a hobby for a lot of people. I know it's the activity I like to do most when I want to just unwind and get away from a computer or television and just release some stress and get outside and wander around. It's the perfect excuse to go out in the woods or stroll along the side of a lake or even just walk along a field edge looking for birds. You can do it anywhere. It is a sport in the sense that there's a lot of competition to birding. Some people compete with other people, like trying to see how many species in a certain period of time, who can see the most. That's part of the competition. And so, in fact, we'll talk about one of those competitions in popular culture in a minute, known as a big year. But there's different forms of the competition. Not everybody is a sport birder, but many people are. Some people are actually turned off by the sport side of birding. They consider it you know, much more game than it is an appreciation of the birds. So you get differences of opinion and differences of personality in reference to that sport aspect of birding. It has certainly become more popular. There are literally millions of people in America that say that they're a birder of some kind. And 30 years ago, it might've been hard to find a few birders. So it's interesting. It certainly has become more popular and is due to popular books and movies, as you'll see in a minute, has helped increase the popularity of birding as an activity. Because of this popularity, it's becoming an economic force. You know, to go birding, you don't need much. You need a field guide and a binocular minimally, but good field guides and good optics cost money, and people are willing, you know, as a hobby, they're willing to pay for those things. If you really get into birding, you need multiple forms of optics. You need a spotting scope. You may need some kind of sound recorder if you get into sounds and songs. So there's many things you end up buying if you get into birding. Some people get into bird photography, so they need blinds and good cameras and good lenses. And so there's many ways that the act of looking for birds, either as a birder or as a bird photographer, adds to economic value and the economy in general when people spend money. And then one aspect of birding I really like is the citizen science aspect. And we have a whole lecture dedicated to eBird, which is a platform for recording your bird observations in such a way that the data can be used by scientists from all around the world. And this is a system maintained by the Cornell University Ornithology Laboratory. So we'll talk about that at another lecture. But to me, this is a very important reason that I bird is I like the idea that my observations might be useful to science. So practically, I'd say 99% of the time when I go out bird watching or birding, I'm actually using a citizen science app to record my observations. All right, so let's talk about birding in popular culture. When I was a young kid, birding was kind of looked on in the movies as a nerdy occupation. It was always the horn-rimmed glasses kind of person, social introvert that was sort of portrayed as a birder, a bird watcher. And more recently, the sporting aspect of birding has been sort of featured based on this book called The Big Year, in which this describes competition between three men in particular who were trying to see the most species in North America, American Birding Association territory, in a single year. And there's some comical aspects to that sport that were portrayed in the book and then later in the movie. These characters, Owen Wilson, Steve Martin, and Jack Black, portrayed the men that were featured in the Big Year book, which is a real biographical account of the competition. Here's a clip of that movie just to show you the sporting aspect of it.
You ever get the feeling you're being followed?
Hello, Master. How you doing, Stu? Still filling those weekends, I see. Unless you and your son here are doing a big year.
Oh, Kenny Bostick, this is my friend, Brad Harris, who's also not doing a big year.
Big-footed goose! Big-footed goose, other end of the boardwalk!
Oh, be careful.
Excuse me. Hey, put her down!
Hey.
Please, let the explorers through.
Of course.
Let's go, ladies. Jeez.
After you kids, get those badges.
Chop, 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 chop. Step it up, stepping lightly.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Moving along. Thank you. Took off, headed north, tried being iced by Friday. Of course, she was a beaut, too. Is that a calliope? Sorry to disappoint you boys. Again.
Okay, sorry about that. So in that particular movie clip, Jack Black is actually portraying the character, although he's not called that in the movie, this character Greg Miller, the guy in the red hat. And these are pictures from a winter birding festival that I attended in the winter of 2014. Up at Zach Zinn Bog, which is a big natural bog. It's a million acre natural bog area west of Duluth, Minnesota. And this was in February. I remember the first day the wind chill was minus 35. you'd think it's kind of an odd thing to have a winter bird festival. But what's cool about this bird festival is the reason people go there is, and there were 150 people there. And Greg Miller was one of them. He was the guest speaker, and I got to bird with him on a day. I sat next to him on a bus. And but the reason people go there is there's these unique birds like this great gray owl or these red poles. They're different species of red poles, and there's probably 15 to 20 other species of birds that are unique to this area that winter here. They actually come out of the boreal forest of Canada, many of these bird species, and they can only be found in this particular area. And so people come to this festival just to see that. And I was there for two, I think it's a 3 day festival. I was there for all 3 days. And I got to meet Greg Miller, and we talked about his life as it was portrayed in the movie. super nice guy. And we'll talk a little bit more about Greg later, because he's Mississippi Ornithological Society invited speaker for our fall meeting, which is coming up pretty soon. But anyway, that's who Jack Black loosely portrayed in the movie. All right, just to show you this competition side of the sporting side of birding, this is a fella named Noah Stryker, who completed a big year. Now, what's a big year? Well, a global big year, not a United States big year. He wanted to see how many species of birds can I see in a single year. And you can see he got up over 6,000 species, which is quite impressive since there's only between 9 and 10,000 species of birds known. So he saw two-thirds of them, let's say, or 60% of them. Notice he went to 41 countries on 7 continents, and look at the field guides he had to use. What's cool about his story is that you can read about it. It's on the internet in various places, is that he wasn't a rich guy. You know, he had to have some money to travel. But what was cool is there's this network of birders that developed and basically would help him as guides and even provide beds for him to sleep in as he went from country to country. So he would sort of announce, okay, I'm in this area seeing this bird. Over the next few days, I plan to go here, here, and here to see this. And he would get volunteers to help find those birds for him and help, you know, to basically take care of them so he could go a little cheaper than most people would have had to if they had to spend money on their own. But you can see it's a game. You try to see as many species as you can. It's grueling and it's something that's something I will never do. But certainly some people enjoy that kind of competition. Notice his record. I mean, when he got 6,042 species, and I think that was 2011. I'm not sure the year when he did that. But anyway, it was broken within the next year by someone else. So that's the way these sports records are. They're meant to be broken. Again, so the bird on the book on the left by Ken Kaufman, this is the book that got me interested in birding. Ken Kaufman, this is about Ken Kaufman when he was a youngster. I think he was 16 years of age, and it was in the early 70s, early to mid 70s, and times were a little freer then. Anyway, Ken, as a youngster, just wanted to take a summer and see as many birds as possible all across the United States. And so he asked his parents if he could hitchhike across the country. And although they were hesitant, they went ahead and let him do it. So it's the story of his adventure. And I think he ended up hitchhiking two or three times. He crisscrossed the country more than once to see birds. And he even got to meet his hero, which was Roger Torrey Peterson, during this episode. And it's just a fun description of an adventure of a young teenager, you know, trying to see as many birds as possible. And it was a fun book to read. It's the kind of book you can read in one sitting if you're really into it. And then the book on the right is a more recent book by Victor Emmanuel, and he's a bit of birder his whole life. And in fact, he's one of the first guys to have a bird touring group. In fact, his bird group, tour group still exists, Victor Emmanuel Tours. In fact, I have some friends who have worked as guides for those tour groups. And this is his recent book. I think it was a couple years ago that he wrote it. And again, these are just bird books about birders and why they go bird and the driving force behind what they do that can add some enrichment to your understanding of birders. Not to leave the women out, these two books are actually about women birders. The first one's kind of disturbing. It's about Phoebe Snetsinger. She's an interesting character. She was a woman who was sort of a victim of the 50s in the sense that she ended up marrying a rich man. I think he was a Kellogg. And when she married him, she kind of gave up her dream of sort of being a biologist. I think she wanted to be a biologist in college and gave up that dream to sort of have kids and be a wife. But then she got a diagnosis of cancer, and her doctor said at that time, hey, you only got months to live. And she had just gotten into birding or bird watching at that time. And she thought, well, if I'm going to die, I'm going to try and see as many birds as possible before I die. And I forget exactly how many years later. I want to say 15 to 20 years later, she did die eventually. in a bus crash in Madagascar when she saw, I want to say it was her it might have been her 8,000 something bird. So she became mildly obsessed with this thing. And I don't want to spoil the book for you, but she actually experienced some criminal acts against her while she's birding, and she can't seem to stop herself. And she goes back to dangerous zones time and time again just to see birds. So it's an interesting book about obsession of birding. One that's a little less about the obsession, but more about just sort of how women in general in a certain time were not as respected as men. It's the story of Connie Hager from Rockport, Texas. Now, Rockport, Texas is not too far from the Aransas Pass where the whooping cranes are. Connie started teaching herself bird watching when she and her husband owned a hotel along the beach. And she would help run the hotel and then get bored and just go out and do some bird watching. And she started teaching herself about birds. And then she started reporting weird birds, and people thought she was crazy. There's no way that bird is there. And it turned out she was right. And so she was questioned a lot by men when she reported seeing certain things. And then over time, she built up a reputation of actually finding rare birds. And she was quite a good birder. And in fact, some of the best birders in the country, including Roger Torrey Peterson and his friends, visited her and got to see how good she was. And she actually became sort of a star in the birdwatchers' world. And in fact, birdwatchers, whenever they visited the Texas Gulf Coast, were invited to stay at her hotel. And she treated them really well and gave them guided tours of places to bird in the area. So that hers is less obsessive, and it's more about competence and respect for women. So that's one reason I like that book is everybody underestimated her value as a birder, and she proved everybody wrong. So that's a good one to read too. So that's what I mean is these books about birders touch on birding, but also on the humanity of the birders themselves. So it makes it kind of a nice books to read. Similarly, this guy, Pete Dunn, I've introduced you to him before. He's actually quite a prolific bird writer, a writer about birds. He's written many books. These are just some of them, but he also writes regular columns and articles in birding magazines and journals. And he's a quite funny guy. So he has a good perspective on birds and birding. And I enjoy just about everything I've read from him. So, you know, the book on the left is just sort of, you know, a guide to how to do it. And then I've already told you about his fishing. And then the book on the right is more of a personal antidotes, funny stories about being someone who didn't have a lot of money once in his life, wanting to go out and look for birds and some of the things he would encounter. So he's a fun guy. Anything he's written, I've enjoyed. So I highly recommend his writings as well. All right, so let's get to what you need. And the first thing you're gonna need is a binocular. And basically a binocular is a double telescope to where each barrel of the telescope, each telescope sees the same thing, the way they're built. And so to get out there and see birds, you know, even birds that are relatively close to you are small. You know, a warbler is maybe only 4 inches long, and if it's 80 feet up in a tree, it's hard to see. And so you need some kind of magnification to bring that bird closer to you, and so you can see more detail and be able to discern it from other species that might be 4 inches long and also in the same treetop. So get out there and look is basically what you need to do, but you got to look with something more than just your eyes, so you need a binocular. And binoculars can be divided into three classes. You got your compact, mid-size, and full size, and it's just based on the overall weight and size of the binocular, which is also a function of the objective lens. That's the front lens, the biggest lens on the front. And you can see the loose definitions here. Basically, if you're less than 30 millimeters across, you're a compact binocular. If you're between 30 and 40, you're mid-size, and if you're greater than 40, you're full-size binocular. I would always recommend a full-size binocular simply because it captures more light, but I'm also a bigger guy and the extra weight doesn't bother me as much. If you're a smaller woman, maybe 115, 120 pounds, you might want something mid-size. I'm always thinking more in terms of optics and light. So if I can go full-size, I'm going to. I definitely don't think compact's going to be something you want during bird watching. I would say full size is my first, and if you had to go down, go ahead and go down to mid-size. But let that be a function of your experience with the binocular and not being comfortable with the full-size binocular. Now let's talk about the binoculars. What kind you usually want to choose. Most bird magazines and birders recommend as a standard birding binocular an 8x40 or an 8x42. The 8 stands for the magnification on the front lens, and the 42 stands for the millimeters diameter of the lens on the objective lens. And so one thing you want to notice is you want a ratio of 5 between those two numbers. So if you got a binocular that magnifies 8 times, you want 8 times 5, at least a 40 millimeter lens on the front. And that's usually a good ratio for birding binoculars. When you look at the binocular, you have your eye cups, and these allow you to adjust the eye relief, you know, how far your eyes are from the lens surface. These eye cups can rotate, and most of them have 3 positions. One that's all the way in is as close as your eyes can get to the lens. There's a middle setting, and then there's an out setting that puts your eyes as far from the binoculars as possible. I tend to be comfortable with the eye cups all the way out, but I have a friend who's more comfortable with the eye cups all the way in. So it just depends on your feel for the binocular against your face. The diopter adjustment is because your two eyes may not see with the same physiological ability. You may have one eye that sees better than another. So the idea is you can actually adjust for that difference between your two eyes, and that diopter adjuster allows you to do that. And we'll talk about that in a minute, but I also have a handout that's in the module that you can download. It talks about how to adjust a binocular for your eyes. But basically what you do, I'll go ahead and go over. What you do is you look through the binocular at an object that's about 100 feet away, and you wink your right eye and use the focus knob, which is in the middle there, where the 8x42 is. That's your focus knob. And what you do is you look through, winking your right eye, and adjust the binocular until you get a crisp focus of an object that's 100 feet away. And then you close your left eye and look at it with your right eye, take your finger off the focus wheel, and then adjust the diopter ring there on your right side until your right eye sees the image as crisp as your left eye did. And what you want to do is repeat that several times. And some of these diopters actually have a number to them. Others just have a position to them. But what you want to do is sort of average it. Do it several times. And if your diopter gives you a number, take the average of those. You know, let's say you do it 5 times. Take the average diopter adjustment and set the binocular there for your standard viewing. And that's just a way to make sure the binocular is adjusted for both eyes. All right, so which binocular do you buy? Well, it's like buying a car in the sense that, you know, the way I look at it is I first think about my budget, how much money do I have to spend? And for that amount of money, I try and get the best binocular that I can. And then the best binocular one is that feels good. It's not too heavy, it's not too light. It has the right, you know, it has the right feel on your face, you know. It feels comfortable in your hands. It's not too heavy, doesn't make you shake. And so that's what we mean by feel. The cost, again, you can spend, there are many levels of spending. You can get a decent pair of binoculars for $100, but you can get a really nice pair of binoculars for between $300 and $500. And you can get exceptional binoculars for $1,000, and you can get the top of the line for $2,000. So cost is something you just have to set up front that's based on all other factors. You know, if you're a first-time birder and you don't even know if you're going to like this hobby, maybe you want to stay on the low end. But if you've been birding a while and really know you're going to be doing this for a long time and you want the best money you can buy, then you save up and you get the best that you can buy at the time. So it's kind of like a computer. That's what I mean. It's like a computer. Size, again, I recommend the full-size binoculars if you can. Definitely don't go too much smaller than a mid-size. You'll be disappointed in your ability to find birds if you go too small. So again, I think most birding magazines are suggesting that birders use 8x magnification. I have both 8x and 10x. I can tell you this, the 10x binoculars, by the end of the day, with that much magnification, when you start to fatigue a little bit and get a little shaky, you start to get headaches because the images shake too much when you're trying to use the 10x. That shake is much more minimized when you're using 8x magnification. If you're using 8x magnification, you want a 40, you want, remember the number is 5, you want a ratio of 5 between the objective lens and the magnification. So if it's 8x, you want a 40 to 42 millimeter lens. If it's 10x, you want a 50 millimeter lens. So I have an 8x42 and I have a 10x50 binocular. And I often use the 10x50 either early in the day or if I'm looking at specific objects that aren't moving too much, you know, a more passive bird, a bird that's maybe it's a duck pair staying up on a lake that aren't moving too much. And I use the 8x42s for more standard birding, you know, looking for birds in trees and where the birds are actively moving and moving speedily through the trees. So I tend to use the 8x42s for that. So again, it's highly recommended as a full-size binocular, an 8x40 to 42 millimeter. And when we talk about binoculars, we actually have two types of prisms we can talk about. The older style of binoculars have what are called poro prisms. They're shown on the left there. And you can see look at the path of the light. It tends to bend across several surfaces before it eventually reaches your eyes. And so because of this, the actual amount of light, the light intensity reaching your eyes is much more reduced in these old poro prisms. Also, the binoculars that have poro prisms tend to be heavier to hold the prisms. So they're bulkier, they're heavier binoculars. And so for that reason, roof prisms have become really popular. You have greater brightness in these binoculars and they often weigh much lighter than a poro prism binocular of the same magnification. So I'd say most birders I know have moved completely to roof prisms and most of the best optics these days tend to be roof prisms, but there are still some people who like the poro prisms. All right, so now we have to talk about magnification. One of the reasons you want an 8x42 over a 10x50 most of the time is this thing called field of view. We have higher magnification, you have a lower field of view. And what that field of view means is when you're looking out over a distance, let's say 1,000 yards away, you're seeing less of the field available to you because you're magnified up so much. And when you're looking for a 4-inch bird in a canopy of a tree that's 80 feet away, you need to see as much of that field of view as possible because that tiny bird is moving around a lot and you want to try and keep up with it and pan with it. If you miss it because you've got your field of view so small that you miss the bird because of the high magnification, you may never find it. So that's one reason the 8x42s are preferred over the 10x50s by most birders is because they have a larger field of view, it's easier to find fast moving birds that are far away from you. Because you can see the entire more of the field of view and see them as they move. So keep that in mind. The higher the mag, the lower the field of view. And this is just an example of it. This is a rifle scope showing you the concept of field of view. On the left is lower magnification. You can see much more of the field of view. You can see across the geese. And then as you zoom in, you really tight with high magnification, you get much less field of view. You're right on the geese. But if those geese start to move, of course, these are geese and they're bigger, but if the animal was small and starts to move fast, you may not be able to keep up with it because you can't see the whole field of view. So that's what we mean by field of view at higher magnification being lower. So here it is just shown here. And one of the points I want to make here is when you buy a binocular, you know, different binocular have this different degree set between the objectives. You want at least a 6 to 6.3 degree set. Sometimes you can go bigger, 7 to 8 degree, but you got to be careful you don't get too wide because you have other trade-offs then when you get real wide. But at least have a 6 degree angle. I think I've got some that are 7 degree or 8 degree, and those are fine. But here's what we mean by field of view. At 1,000 yards, you know, an 8x42 is going to give you 315 feet field of view. That's the kind of thing you're looking at when you talk about field of view. And if you go bigger magnification, that reduces to maybe 220 feet or something like that. You know, that's what we move by field of view. All right, so let's say you've decided on binocular. Do you need a spotting scope? Well, you may not if you're just new to birding and you don't know if you're going to ever get in a situation where you're going to look at birds that need a telescope. But more often than not, if you stay in birding for your life as a hobby, you're going to want a telescope or a spotting scope. And again, it's the same considerations. They can be very expensive. This one's cheap, $400, $500 scope. But some of the best ones are over $2,000, $2,500. So it's what you could spend. Just as important, because spotting scopes or telescopes, you need a stable base to them. So you need a good tripod. And a good tripod doesn't shake a lot. It's not wobbly, because if you spend $2,000 on a spotting scope, but you got a flimsy tripod, you're wasting your money. You need a rock hard, solid tripod that's not too heavy for carrying around out in the woods. So tripod considerations are just as important as the scope itself. It needs to be rugged. One of the reasons I tend to go cheaper and middle of the road in optics is because I'm so rough with things. This is a spotting scope I've had for 15 years. It's been beat up. I can't tell you how many times I've dropped it in the mud and the water, banged it against tree limbs and such, and it still keeps on ticking. And so probably if I spent $2,500 on it, I'd be afraid to take it out because I'm so rough with them. So I tend to buy a little more cheap and worry less when I'm traipsing around the woods than I would if I had something more expensive. Maybe that's not the right attitude, but that's just the way I am. I do look at telescopes as important tools, not just for viewing birds, but also for documenting that their rarity may occur. So this idea of hooking a cell phone camera up to a spotting scope is known as digiscoping. And it's a way to take pictures and videos of birds that you're seeing through your telescope. And I certainly do like to do this. And I've recorded many rare bird sightings of my own using this technique. I quickly get the scope set on the bird, slide my phone camera on there, and take pictures or video to try and document that, hey, yeah, I really did see this bird. And I can download that evidence and show people to prove that I saw the bird. So that's part of my birding, regular birding attire, is to be able to use my spotting scope as a camera. Size, again, it's a lot like the binoculars. They vary. Many of them have zoom lenses on them. Mine is 25x to 60x zoom. Some of them go as low as 15 to 60x zoom. Those are the two standards. It's either 15 to 60 or 25 to 60x zoom. You can get objective lenses that are 60 to 88 millimeter. I think the bigger the objective, the better. I think mine is 85, 86 millimeter. But anyway, with the bigger objective, of course, the more light you get. And this is really important at higher magnifications because as magnification goes up, the amount of light reaching your eyepiece actually goes down. So the bigger the lens, the more light. And that's sort of the considerations for a spotting scope. And now you've got field guides. And of course, this little kitty doesn't really need to know what birds it's going to eat, but we'll pretend she does care. There are different kinds of field guides. There's all kinds of them out there. I think this is Kaufman's field guide. I've got them all. And what do you look for in a field guide? Well, field guides do many different things for you. One, it allows you to compare different species that might be in an area at the same time. So it'll show you field marks to look for through your binoculars to help you discern which species you're looking at. But they also provide distribution maps so you can say, okay, am I likely to even see this bird in this area that I'm bird watching in? So these range maps are very important. And then the field guides that allow you to compare different species, either with photographs like this one or color plates. So what should your strategy be? Well, when you first get into birding, I recommend you just sort of read and study the different birds you expect to find in your neighborhoods, your backyard, let's see. And then if you do go out bird watching, one of the things you don't want to do is to sort of have the field guide in your hand while you're out walking around looking at birds. In fact, I highly recommend you just leave your field guide in your car, get out, take a hike, look at the birds, try and concentrate on what you're seeing, and then come back and consult the field guide. The idea is to learn how to look at birds and look at details in the field, try to remember what you see, and then compare to the field guide. If you open the field guide in the field, you'll end up looking down at the pages, and while you're doing that, the bird's gone. And so you spend less time looking at the bird and more time looking at the book. So look at the birds first, try and get a mental image of what you saw, and you got to train yourself on what to look for. You got to say, okay, what kind of bill did it have as quick as you can? What kind of feet? What were the primary colors? What stood out? You know, was there some kind of sound or voice? And those are the kind of things you need to do. And this idea of consulting more than one field guide is a good one. Audubon field guides tend to be photographic. And I tend to, over the time, I've learned that photographic field guides are fine, but the photographs usually describe one individual bird, and that bird that's in that book may not be the good average expected individual, and account for variations. Whereas when people paint plates, use watercolor plates in a book, they often are looking at 20 or more specimens to make the watercolor or the diagram of the bird that's in the field guide. And they've made that image by looking at many different birds. So consult many field guides. Look at those that have photographs. Also look at those that have good color plates. Expect variations. You know, not all humans are alike. Well, not all birds are alike, even in the same species. And there are weird genetic mutations. There are weird geographic variation in color. So expect things not to look exactly like the field guide. And then people are always asking, what field guides do you recommend? Here are the top three that I like to have at all times in my car and also at my home, my desk at home. I have many other field guides, don't get me wrong, but these are the three standbys. I use Peterson's field guide, the National Geographic, and then Sibley's. And all of these are plates. All the birds represented are either diagrams or plates, but then I also have a phone app that uses plates and photographs. So I also have photographs in my phone app. So these are the three I like to have. Of these, Peterson's my favorite just because it's the oldest, but I think Sibley's my next favorite just because I think his plates and diagrams of birds are wonderful. When I look at a bird at a Sibley, I'm always find it remarkable how close to actually capturing what birds look like he has done with his paintings are pretty good. And then this is an interesting book, Pete Dunn again. He wrote this book, it's an essential field guide companion, and then it's based on general impression of shape and size. We'll talk about GIS later. We're gonna talk about GIZMO. They've added some extra letters to the acronym. But what's cool about this book is that there's no pictures or distribution maps. This is a book solely about the birds. It's about behavioral descriptions, the habitat you find them in, how to compare them quickly to other birds, anything unique you need to know about their biology. And it's written in a very fun way by someone who's observed birds his whole life. And so this is a very good book to read. I like to read it after I've observed a bird for the first time. Maybe it's my first time ever seeing a certain species, and I've saw it once or twice, but I don't know as much about it as I'd like to. So I grab his book and I read it, and I usually am greatly enriched by his knowledge of birds. And then the next time I see the bird, I pay attention to some of the things he described. And so I feel like I learn more by using this field guide companion. Again, there are bird apps. There are many different ones. Again, the same guides I just mentioned, you know, you got Audubon guides, Peterson guides, you got several others, Bird Explorer Plus. Just there's a variety of bird apps out there. The one I tend to like is iBird Pro, and I use it. I have an Android, so there's an iBird Pro for Androids, and I just like it because I enjoy the plates and the distribution maps, and then there's a nice sound collection for each bird that they present, and it's just an app I've grown to accustomed and I use regularly. There's also apps to help you identify birds, and this one is called Merlin, And so there's two ways Merlin works. It can quiz you about basics about your bird. You know, what's its relative size? What are the main colors? What's the bird? And it asks you some basic places. Was that a feeder on the ground, in trees, on water, that kind of thing? And then you keep inputting, and then you finally get to a point where you hit submit, and it'll kind of give you the top three guesses or so of the bird they think it could be for your area. Another cool feature of Merlin, I tested this one recently because I'd never really used Merlin because I had already gotten to a place where I knew where most of the birds in our area were. So I didn't really need it to learn how to identify birds, but I wanted to test it to see how good it was. And this is where if you have a photograph that you took on your phone, and I often take them with my scope, like I showed you before, you can actually take your photograph, zoom in on the bird, and ask Merlin to give you an idea what that bird is. And it'll crunch the number, ask you where you are, it'll crunch the image, and then ask you where you're located, and it'll give you the top three options. And I took an afternoon and I put in 32 species of birds, and Merlin got 31 right. And the one it didn't get right was because I put in a very tricky species. There are these two species of ducks, the greater and lesser scop, that look very much alike. And my photograph was poor and it made a mistake. And it basically said that the one scop, the one species it wasn't, was the first choice, and the species it was the second choice. So it was still pretty good. So these apps are pretty good about identifying photos if you've got a decent photo of a bird. Now, let's talk about when you're actually out there looking at the birds. So again, look at your field guides before you go out, know the habitat you're going to visit, and know what to expect in that habitat. You know, you're likely to find this marsh wren near a marsh, not near a meadow. So if you're out near water at a certain time of year, you might expect to find a marsh wren. So when you see a bird, you want to quickly discern, because you may only get 5 to 10 seconds of seeing the bird if you're lucky. So you get overall pattern, shape of the bird. You know, look at that tail. It's nearly straight up, vertical, like a flag. You see the long bill, how it's climbing up a twig, and then habitat and range and season. So this obviously is a marsh wren, and it's going to be found near marshes. Look at the color of the bird. Overall, is it, you know, there are to be pink birds in our area. We do have the rosette spoonbill, and American flamingo is very rare in our area. So if you see a pink bird up here, large pink wader is probably a rosette spoonbill. But you have to get the dominant colors, which might be hard for something like a painted bunting, or for something like a yellow warbler, it's either overall yellow, green, or yellow. So you want to discern the color. And then the other thing you want to eventually get is overall size of the bird. We've seen this before. Sexes can be dimorphic. Males are oftentimes more handsome than females. Females tend to be more drab because they're trying to be more concealed when they're sitting on nest. So here's the male and female indigo buntings. Similar age, many species of birds do not reach their mature plumage until they're 4 or 5 years old. Here's a good example. The bird on the left is an adult bald eagle, and the bird on the right is a juvenile, probably in its first season. And it'll take that juvenile 4 to 5 years to look to have a solid white head and a solid white tail with an all brown body to be looking like an adult. It'll take it 4 to 5 years to do that. There are seasonal variations. You know, American goldfinch, when they're breeding, are bright yellow. Males are bright yellow, but in the non-breeding, they get dull and lose that yellow. You can almost see no yellow in them all. It's kind of a dull grayish yellow look to them, and they lose their black cap. So unfortunately for us in Starkville, we have a few breeding goldfinch around, but not too many of them, but we have many more goldfinch in the wintertime, and so we see them when they're not their prettiest. European starlings, even though they're an introduced bird, we see them a lot. What you'll see with them is pretty cool. I'm starting to see fresh plumage individuals right now. They look very different when those feathers wear during the winter. As they use them more and more, the feathers wear and the birds actually look very different in appearance. They turn darker and less white looking. And of course, when you look at birds, you just want to get a general feel for the bill. You know, if you see a very sharp hooked bill, like in this Cooper's hawk, that's a raptor, and then the talons to match, you know, it's a bird of prey. And you see this big, strong, stabby, sword-like bill on the great blue heron and the long legs, you know, that's a wader that's probably wading through water, looking for prey like snakes, fish, and things like that, crawfish. And then this woodpecker, I think that's probably, I can't tell if it's a downy or a hairy, but it's a woodpecker. And you can see the bill, and then there's the feet for grabbing the tree. So you want to pay attention to overall body color, size, bill, and shape of the legs. They clue you in on the what the kind of bird it is. And then you really do need to kind of nail down in your mind relative size. So it's really good when you first start birding to sort of identify these common birds and get an idea of their size, because you may want to, when you find a new bird, you want to say, well, it was about the size of a blue jay, but it was smaller than a crow, you know, that kind of thing. You want to be able to kind of put your unknown bird into size categories in between these known species. And that'll kind of help you eliminate options when you're trying to identify a bird you've never seen before and you're consulting a field guide. So it's good to learn these few size bird sizes and use them to compare to birds you don't know. And then behavior, you know, if you see a nuthatch has a unique way of walking down trees and sticking their head out, and there aren't too many birds that look like a nuthatch when they behave this way. An eastern phoebe, it's a flycatcher we have all winter long, and one of the distinctive features of this bird is that it bobs its tail. When it's perched, you'll see it constantly lifting its tail and bobbing it. And there aren't too many other flycatchers in our area that do that. So if you see a flycatcher in the wintertime especially, you see it all year round around here, but if it bob its tail, it's likely an eastern phoebe. And of course, you have large flocks of birds, you know, it's a behavioral defense being together. And this is just a giant flock of snow geese. There's probably other geese embedded in there, but that's a good behavioral cue for types of birds is, you know, do they flock in large mass in the wintertime? All clues as to the bird identity. Now, we only have Lapland longspur for the most part in our area on a regular basis, but this is a good example, so I decided to leave it in. In Arkansas, they actually have these two longspurs could be found in the state. And you can see the birds look very similar. Their facial patterns are the similar, size is similar, overall colors are kind of the same. But one big difference is where they're found. Lapland longspurs are found basically in open ground with very little vegetation most of the time, whereas Smith's longspurs are found in very grassy meadow habitats. So if you find if you're out in a grassy meadow and a longspur flies up, and it's more likely to be a Smith than it is a Lapland. So that's where you can use habitat to your advantage. If you're unsure about an ID, is just use habitat as a way to eliminate one option. And again, we've talked about mats before, but you've got to learn what to expect during certain times of the year. You know, painted bunnings are only here in the summertime. They're here for breeding and they're gone during the wintertime. Ring-bill gulls are the opposite. They tend to be here only in the wintertime, which is orange on these maps. So we're going to tend to see more and more of those as our season goes on, October forward. And then birds like Carolina chickadees are resident birds that are here year-round. So in Mississippi, you can see this bird any time of the year. And you'll get a feel for that as you do more bird watching. You'll know which ones are here in the summer, which ones are here in the winter, which ones are here year-round, and which ones are the ones we only see during migration, because there's some that's all you do is see them when they're moving through. They never stay. They just move through for a few days. As mentioned in a previous presentation, learning bird sounds is an important aspect of bird watching or birding, especially in the spring and summertime when leaves are full of foliage. It's very difficult sometimes to see birds, songbirds that are hiding in the trees, because they can hide so well in the camouflage of the leaves. So sounds, calls and songs in particular can be very important in helping to, number one, find the birds and also to identify certain birds. The song you've been hearing in the background here is actually the song of the wood thrush. which is a very haunting song you often hear in southern woodlands in the springtime. It's one of my favorite songs. And of course, birds use songs to announce territories and courtship. They use the songs for courtship and territory announcements. And the territory announcements are basically warning rival males, hey, this is my breeding territory. If you come closer, I'll end up in combat and dispute over the area. And then, of course, courtship is used to consummate reproduction and the raising of offspring together. And then there's just contact between family members, between members of a pair. And then once they have offspring, you often have birds calling between each other or begging to be fed. As in that bottom there, you see a blue jay that's begging to be fed. And so sounds in birds are communicating many different things, just like in humans are. We use language for many different things. Birds use sounds, calls, and songs for many different aspects of their biology. And they can be important clues to help you identify them. So we've talked about mnemonics before. The mnemonics for the songs of these birds we're going to look at in a minute are in blue. So we've heard Herb Bob White before, and here's the actual song. Okay. Now let's try the killdeer. And again, it says his name. Some people say killdee or killdeer. Now, one thing I should say is there are many mimics of these birds out there. And in fact, I've got a mockingbird in my yard that's pretty good at mimicking killdeer calls. It's fooled me more than once. So keep that in mind. There are some birds that mimic the calls and songs of other birds. Here's a robin, and they have a kind of a sing-songy song. Commonly heard in the spring and summertime here. Here's the barred owl, one of our most common owls. And if you go to the Knoxby National Wildlife Refuge, you can often hear these birds calling at all times of the day, actually. Very distinct call. And then a bird you've less likely heard around here, although I know of a few nesting pair over the years. We tend to hear more of these northward along the Mississippi River going into the Memphis area. I've seen a few. Warbling vireo. And it's a very long mnemonic, but it's a very complex sing-songy song. But nothing else sounds like that warbling vireo song. So anyway, that's just a few to show you how important sound can be. All right, so there are different ways you can learn the songs and sounds of birds. This is the series I grew up on and learned. It's Birding by Ear series and the Stokes Field Guides. I believe the Birding by Ear series for the East Central was a 3D CD set, and then the Field Guide to Bird Songs Stokes on the Western region, I think, was a 4 CD set, and they had an Eastern side, it was a 3 CD set. But these are both very good. Again, these were CDs. I'm sure you can get them in different digital formats now. But these are excellent ways to start learning bird sounds and songs of our common birds. There are apps that also will play the bird sounds for you. I know my iBird Pro offers songs and sounds and alarm calls for most species of birds in that app. There's actually apps that you can tap record and using your smartphone speakers, aim it at your bird and record the bird. And then after you're done recording it, it will process it and give you the most likely sounds that would match that bird. Notice that some of these apps have bird safe modes, and we'll talk about the ethics of birding later, but one of the things you don't want to do is play bird sounds, the bird songs in the field, in most places that are wildlife refuges or wildlife management areas or parks. If nothing else, you're going to offend the people, but some people worry about the harm it has in the biology of the birds, and we'll talk more about that later. So this is a tool for recording and analyzing, but not for playing back on birds. And here's a similar app. These phone apps are good because if you have your GPS location enabled, the app knows where you are, and so it automatically knows on the distribution map, you know, of the likely species that the song matches, is the bird likely to be found in your area. So that's what these apps are good for. I've never used the Song ID app just because I had learned the sounds with the CDs, and I never invested money in the app, so I don't know how good they are. Here's something I do. This is a fella named Nathan Piplow. He's out of Colorado. This is a little bit of his biography, but he's written the Peterson Guide to the bird sounds of North American birds, and you can get Eastern North American. I think he has a similar guide to the West, and I have the Eastern guide, of course. And what's really cool about his book is he gives the most common sounds, songs and calls. And what he does is he shows the sonograms. These are traces of the sound over time for each song. And it turns out these sonograms are sort of visual representation of the sounds you hear. And what I like about it is if I'm unsure about a bird ID, sometimes I'll record the sound. Sometimes a bird stays hidden in the brush. It's calling or singing at me, but I can't see the bird real well. So I'll record its sound and I'll say, okay, I really did think that was a so-and-so, let's say a great cat bird. I think the bird I have on the next slide is a northern water thrush. So I think the bird is a northern water thrush. I record the sound and then I actually upload it to my eBird program. And when I upload it, I get this sonogram of the bird's song. And then what I can do is I can print that sonogram or take a picture of it like I did here. And then I can actually go to his book and for the common sounds of the bird, see if it matches the sonogram he has published in his book. And I've been doing this to teach myself bird sounds, and it's amazing how good the sonograms can give you a visual representation of what you're hearing. So here's a sonogram and here's the actual soundtrack that was made from. Okay, so you heard the chip notes and then eventually the song. And you can see the the area of the sonogram that's in the white is the part that's being highlighted now. So you can see all the chip notes the bird was doing in front, then the one song phrase, and then it returned to chip notes. But you can see how you can use a sonogram and look up and match the bird. So one way to help confirm an ID is to not only get a good look at the bird, but if you can't see it, maybe you can use the sound and look up the sonogram and match. So as you become a birder, you develop skills. You learn to quickly because you know seeing a bird, you may only have a few seconds to see a bird. You try and see as much as you can. So for example, you look at this hawk, and what you should notice right away is it's a very chunky looking hawk with wide wings. And chunky hawks tend to belong to the family Buteo, same family as a red-tailed hawk. But then the next thing you should notice is the tail. And notice it's banded. You got a heavy black band, white band, and then another black band. So it has a few bands and they tend to be broad. The wings are wide. And then a key feature too is the front edge of this wing is not black, which is something you see in the red-tailed hawk. And so when you see that, you should quickly, automatically, if you know Buteos at all, you would know this was a broad-winged hawk. Of course, you would have to know, is that bird here? Are we in the right season? Because they migrate. This bird is gone now. It's moved to South America for the winter. So you need to see the bird, consider where you are, what time of year you are, and you should learn to know what to expect. You know, when I walk around Mississippi certain times of the year, this is a bird I would expect to see. Now, if I walk around Mississippi in November, I would not expect to see this bird. And so it would not be on my expectations for that time of year. So that's what I mean by know your expectations. Know which birds are normally found in an area at a certain time of the year. And it helps you when you're looking, because if you're not expecting a broad-winged hawk, you don't necessarily have to look for certain features. And if you do see them, then you know this is a really rare broad-winged hawk out of season if you see it. So That's the kind of thing you need to do. So, and then the other thing is just get out and practice. And so again, study field guides, go out, look at birds, come back to the field guides and do this over and over a zillion times, then you'll eventually catch on. Then just go out with other birders, especially people who've been doing it longer. I was fortunate in my early days, I was able to go out with birding with a professional ornithologist who was curator and professor at LSU for 35, 40 years, Dr. Van Remsen. I was his note taker many times when we'd go out, but just being around him and through osmosis, I learned many things about how to look for birds and he's a very talented guy. Trialing your own, I mean, it's a hobby you're going to want to do on your own. So, start in your backyard, your neighborhood, and be patient. Don't build up incredible expectations. And you're going to make mistakes. This is very important. You're going to mis-ID a lot of birds. Even experienced birders mis-ID birds. One thing to do is to try to learn from your mistakes. Why did I call that bird this when it really was that? What did I see wrong or what did I not see? And those are the kind of things you do to build your base for knowing and understanding birds. And don't get too wrapped up in it. Have fun. If it's a hobby, you don't want this to become so academic and tedious that you don't do it. It's a fun activity. Keep it fun. I do want to emphasize some ethics, though, because so many people are birding. There are things we tend to do sometimes. Number one, probably from excitement, that we just forget just the basic courtesy and things about protecting wildlife. So one of the things is stay on the road and trail. You know, when you're in a national wildlife refuge, national park, or wildlife management area, you know, if you see a bird, see it from the road, don't chase that bird off trail. You know, you damage habitat, you start to affect the way the park was intended to be used, for example. So stay on designated paths and trails and don't deviate because you start to affect other wildlife when you encroach on territory that's not meant for visitors, human visitors. Distance, don't chase birds. You know, see them, chase them a little distance on the road if you're on a path, but don't chase the bird deep into the woods and keep chasing. You just start to disturb its life when you do that. So you don't have to do that. If you can get a quick view on it, move slowly, maybe you get an extra one or two views of it, and that'll be it. But you're not going to get a long view if you chase it. And you just don't want to impact the bird's biology. If it's trying to feed babies and you're chasing it, you're affecting its feeding regime of its young. So just respect the bird. Try and get a good look at it. We can first see it. And if you can't see it within a few feet, then that's too bad. You'll just have to go on to the next bird. Rescues. People, when they find baby birds on the ground, they say, oh, poor baby bird fell out of the nest and yada, yada, yada. Well, what they don't realize is mama bird is right there. Mom and daddy bird are probably looking right at you. They're trying to feed it, coax it along. Best thing for you to do is leave it alone, frankly. If it really is a bird that's falling out of a nest and really needs help or has a broken wing, call and get assistance from veterinarians and rescue people. But don't take it upon yourself to remove the wild animal from its habitat. Most of the time, it's just best to leave it alone and move on. Feeding. Some birders have a bad idea of taking wild bird seed with them when they find a rare bird to sort of try and keep it in place by feeding it. And that's never a good idea. You want to don't bring food into a wild park or a wildlife management area. Let the birds stay on wild diets. Now we all feed birds in our backyard and that's a slightly different thing. You're offering the food to the birds and they can come and take it if they want. But I'm referring to people actually taking food with them to try and bait rare birds to stay a few days longer in an area, a natural area than they would otherwise by trying to bait them with seed. And it's an unethical thing to do and please don't do it. Lights. This has more to do with your own yard and home than anything. But birds get confused by city lights and lights in general, security lights. You know, if you have security lights around your house that stay on constantly, that's really bad for birds. They get confused and often fly into buildings and such. So if you want a security light, it's better to have the infrared detectors that turn the lights on and off when there's an intruder, because that has a lower impact on the birds. So think that way. Reduce the impact of your lighting around your house and home on birds, especially migratory birds, get confused by lights a lot. Sound, this is a tough one. Many people use pishing to attract birds and bring them up, you know, to chase a predator. And you've got to be real careful. There are many places that absolutely forbid pishing, many national wildlife refuges and many birding areas. If you're caught pishing, they'll throw you out. Similarly, you don't want to use recordings and playbacks of species to attract them, especially in areas where birds are breeding. I have used recordings to attract birds, but I almost always do it in the non-breeding part of the season if I'm going to do it at all. And I usually do it during educational outings, and I don't do it necessarily for myself when I'm birding. So minimize your use of sound in pishing when you can, and just be aware that in certain areas, if you do it, you're going to be thrown out of the park. All right. Sighting rule, share sensibly. What this refers to is rarities, rare breeders in particular. Let's say you found a bird that's fairly rare and it's a fragile species, and the last thing you want to do is announce it to the world, hey, I found this rare bird, it's nesting in this tree on the side of this road. And if you put that out there, and we'll talk about eBird later, if you put that record out there and people really want to see that bird, suddenly the next day there'll be 100 people driving to the area to try and find that rare bird. Well, all those people are going to disturb that bird and can dramatically impact its reproductive output of that year if for some reason it stops raising its young or something. So what I usually do is if it's a really fragile species, I withhold the sighting for at least 10 days before I report it on any of the electronic outlets that we'll talk about later. And usually that's enough time that people don't look back and look for it. And there's no rare bird alert to send people that way. So it's just a smart way to keep people from overrunning an area where there's a fragile bird. Of course, no litter. I mean, that makes sense. Pack it in, pack it out. You know, if you bring lunches when you go birding, take out your garbage. It's just common sense. And then engaging. There's a tendency for some birders to chastise the new birders and say, kind of point to their ineptitude, say, oh my God, you called that bird a what? That's not what birding's about, especially when you want to share the joy of the activity. You want to encourage people. And, you know, sometimes people misreport or misidentify, and you can correct them, and some people get offended by it. But anyway, we just want good cooperation among birders, and we don't necessarily want wars about identification. So for example, an eBird, if I make a miss ID, someone could tell me gently, hey, Jeff, you really screwed that ID up, and I could ignore them. Well, rather than create a big uproar, eBird has offered a way for you to go to that sighting and say, look, he misidentified this bird. This is really what it is, and this is why. And you can make a little report, and then the scientists can look at it, make a decision about who's right, and make the correction. So with that, I mentioned that birding groups, mentors are really always good. This is our statewide organization, the Mississippi Ornithological Society. This is our meeting from a few years ago. The reason I bring it up is our fall meeting this year is virtual, and I mentioned Greg Miller earlier, the Jack Black character from A Big Year. He's going to be our guest speaker this year, he'll speak on, you'll see the details there written there on Friday night, I think, that's the 23rd. This is a little bit about Greg at our meeting. So if you're interested, there's the pre-registration for this. You can just go to Mississippi Ornithological Society Fall Meeting website, and you can register and attend that meeting virtually if you'd like, just to get an idea a little bit more about the state organization, but you also get a chance to interact with Greg Miller, this character that was from the movie. And then our local birding group is the Oktibbeha Audubon Society. We haven't been terribly active since COVID-19, but we're thinking about doing some bird outings if we can stay socially distanced in the near future. I'll get back to you on that. Any questions? Thank you for your time.